Welcome to Studio STL. Happy Monday. We are getting you ready for the upcoming holiday, Thanksgiving. And when we think of Thanksgiving, we think about those pilgrims. But what about the American revolutionaries? Well, we are joined with two amazing people who know a thing or two about historic recipes and really history in general. We're hanging out with our celebrity historian, Rafi Andonian, alongside of Nicole Kliebert with Noshings with Nicole. Thank you guys so much for joining me today.
Yeah, Thanksgiving is a great time to have colonial American food.
I know, right? I mean, where do you even come up with the ideas and the recipes that really come from history's past?
So for colonial American food, you have to be really careful with what source you're looking for, because the recipes are so different from how we would read them today. For example, one of the recipes today called for making a good marrow, which is custard. But you would not know that. So you have to go to a good place, like Colonial Williamsburg is really good. Mount Vernon is a really good one. Tasting History with Max Miller. And they study the historic foodways, and then they are able to put it into 21st century language.
Now, that is pretty cool. I had no idea. We just need a good marrow.
One thing to add to that, recipe, when you're really, it's really a little overwhelming. It looks like we have a good amount of food here. This is nothing. So in the colonial period, the period we're talking about, they would have just two courses for a feast. You might say, that's not too much,
right? Two courses?
So here's the thing. Each course has a couple different parts, and each part has multiple dishes. So you end up with 20 to 40 dishes over the course of a Thanksgiving, believe it or not.
What?
That's right.
That is amazing. And Rafi, this is why you are the historian, because I had no idea.
Examples of those dishes. Now, we have some local ones here, or some ones here that she can talk about. But they would eat a lot of meat. Heavy seasoning, heavy salt, heavy sugar, not a lot of fruits and vegetables. So they're eating like you know, they would often they're eating out. Even in St. Louis, a century after the founders in St. Louis, so a different generation, but when St. Louis is really coming on the national scene, they eat not only turkey, but they eat other animals like duck and geese, especially when there was a turkey shortage. And actually, the local paper at some point predicted that pumpkin pie would go downhill and would not be popular, but it remained
popular. Look at us now, 2023, downing all of the pumpkin pie. I mean, so you guys went in, you created and recreated some of these dishes. I mean, what was that process like for you?
So what I did was I took recipes that I thought would be good for the modern day Thanksgiving table. So you have to find some kind of commonalities and something that you're not competing with, like your grandma's best baked macaroni and cheese. So
what
we have turnips over here, and I want you to try them. So turnips are typically not at American Thanksgiving. They're often bitter. These are super sweet and buttery and decadent. They are so not bitter. No, I'm nervous.
Oh my gosh, no. Those are amazing.
I know, it's shocking.
They're not bitter at all.
Who thought turnips could be so good? And there's no sugar in it. So it's all about like the slow cooking method and the butter.
Good. It tastes like a potato.
Yeah,
it with does. Amazing gravy.
Yeah, it's so good. So the next one is cabbage and onions two ways. So especially in the southern part of the U.S., greens are super common at the Thanksgiving. Most of the time they're smoked meat, but this one doesn't. So it's just cabbage and onions and butter, salt, and pepper. And then if you want
it's good and simple. It's not too much either.
It is. It's simple. It's like you can make it like this.
Okay,
you
quick and easy.
Yeah. Then if you wanted to pick this up one notch, then you would just add egg and flour and milk, and then you can go into fritters. So you can essentially make the same recipe, but cook it two different ways, and then you have two completely different dishes.
I like that. Okay, so you said you've added egg and
flour
to this?
Yep.
That's good too.
Yeah, and so one of the things with colonial American fare is it's all very bland looking. It's a lot of creams, browns. So you put like chunks of parsley that kind of brightens up the dish some. Citrus peels are also really common.
These all taste like potato cakes almost.
Well, so it's similar. It's just got, and instead of having potatoes, you would have cabbage.
Oh my gosh.
And now part of the reason that, you know, like she said, a lot of times it would look bland and the base would be bland. That's why they use so much of that seasoning that I was describing. Because they have to make it better, and especially a lot of sugar and salt.
Yeah. Okay, sugar, salt. I mean, it sounds like our Thanksgiving dinner's now, right?
I mean,
if you don't leave the table feeling stuffed, did you really enjoy Thanksgiving?
Of course not.
Questions
you get it like
answered.
On mud in your pants.
Well, you gotta be able to please the crowd.
I can't wait to try these when we come back with St. Louis. We're going to get you up to date and caught up on your news headlines. We're going to sit things inside of our studio with news anchor Amelia McGavro.
Now let's send it back to Chelsea Haynes in Studio STL with all that colonial food.
Oh my gosh, yes. And the colonial food tasted absolutely amazing. We had some turnips, cabbage done two ways. We're hanging out with our celebrity historian as well as Nicole from Noshings with Nicole. Now, Nicole, we kind of saved the best for last today, didn't we?
We did. It's called stuffed apples, and they really need a new name for it because it's so delicate and decadent. But go ahead and try it. I want you to try the custard on the bottom first.
Okay.
So you start out by making a custard. And it has ginger, cinnamon, nutmeg, mace in it, which is similar to nutmeg. And then you peel an apple and you core it, and then you put half of the custard inside of the apple. Taste that one, and
this
then you make
a different custard.
It's the same custard, but it tastes like apple because the apple juices are cooked into it. And then it's got a crispy meringue outside.
That
so you've got
amazing.
All these like different textures and flavors. So go ahead and try the rest of the apple.
Okay.
There's a knife right there.
I'm going to need a knife. I'm probably going to make a mess.
There's a fork too, if that's easier.
If people are interested in like learning about some of your recipes, where can they go and find you?
So noshingswithnicole.com. I'm really good about like substitution. So if you ever have a question, just send me a message on there and I'll get back to you.
Nice. Well, these look so easy and yummy to make. And the custard was amazing. Rafi, thank you so much for being
here
with
us. Remember, food and culture are associated with each other. And this tells the history that you're eating just like your grandma's recipes. This is the founding recipes.
Yep. I love this. The founding father's recipes. So cheers, everybody. That's good.
Don't go anywhere, St. Louis. We'll be right back.